This is a copyrighted work. Unauthorized copying or distribution is a crime punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Scholastic Audio presents Stay Alive, the Journal of Douglas Allen Deeds, The Donner Party Expedition, 1846, by Rodman Philbrick. Read by Andrew Eiden. For my brothers, Philip, Jonathan, and Mark. What happened to the Donner Party expedition during those brutal winter months in 1846 and 1847 is a horror almost beyond description. Almost. Douglas Allen Deeds kept a journal of these awful events, down to the last gruesome detail. Keep listening if you dare. 1. The Way West. May 12, 1846, Independence, Missouri. Today, I embark on a great journey. That's what Mr. George Donner told me to write down when I bought me a vellum-bound journal from the stationery store, but I didn't know what to say.
"The first sentence is always the hardest," Mr. Donner said. "The rest is up to you."
Thank you, Mr. Donner, for thinking up that first sentence, and for letting me tag along on your wagon train, even though I ain't got no kin and no wagon, but only poor old Barney, who don't want to leave Missouri if he can help it. Barney is my horse, which I got when my pa passed. The horse and $100 in gold from selling the farm. That's all I have in the world, but it's enough to get me there, if I'm careful. Last thing I did before leaving Independence was pay my respects to Ma and Pa. I went to the little churchyard with all the pretty white markers and prayed over them and explained how before long my prayers would be coming from California. Ma didn't know about California. She's been gone so long. But Pa did. Before he died, he talked about how there were valleys where it never snowed and crops that grow all year long. California is where a man can eat a fresh peach in December and never be cold, Pa said, which is probably what gave me the idea to join up. May 13th. Our expedition is big and getting bigger. 200 wagons and more every day. When folks hear where we're headed, they sell their land for 10 cents on the dollar and buy a wagon and follow along. George Donner and his brother Jacob organized the train in Springfield, along with Mr. James Reed and Colonel Russell. Mr. Donner says he don't mind all the extra folks. He says there's safety in numbers and plenty of food along the way. All the game we can hunt and good water for the horses. Ho for California! May 14th. We are already 2 long, hard days from Independence, but have made less than 10 miles progress. Mr. Reed says a few more days and we'll be clear of these dense, dark timberlands and out in the open plains where the going will be easier. I asked him how many times he's led settlers through to California, and he gave me a funny look, like I was trying to be insulting, which I wasn't. I have the greatest respect for Mr. Reed and the Donner brothers, even if none of them has never actually been west before. Pa always said there's a first time for everything. I made a new friend today. His name is Edward Breen. His family has 3 wagons and 12 good horses. The way Edward's mother dotes on him reminds me how much I still miss my own ma, even though I was but 5 years old when she passed. I am 15 now, so I pulled my hat brim down so nobody'd see me crying. I felt considerable better afterwards when Mrs. Breen insisted I hitch up with them and eat with them and so on. She's a real nice lady, and I like the soft way she talks, which I suppose is how everybody from Ireland talks. There's a number of other young single men in the party, and mostly they stick together, Some of the bachelors drink hard liquor, which I made a vow never to touch, so I'm glad of the kind invitation to accompany the Breens. While we were walking along, guiding the teams of oxen that pull the wagons, I entertained my new friend Edward by recounting all the Missouri whoppers I could recall. They work better if you give them a honey mouth drawl. He laughed so hard, he spit water through his nose. He especially liked the one about the catfish that swallowed the bear. Edward says when we get to California, maybe me and him can partner up and be surveyors. He says with all the free land being cut out by new settlers, there'll be a shortage of surveyors, marking out the property lines and so on, and we'll prosper. He was so excited about the idea. I didn't tell him I've got my heart set on farming dairy cows, which is what my pa tried to do until he had his run of bad luck. Nobody has ever seen anything like the Donner Expedition. It is 2 miles from the first wagon to the last, and the ground shakes as we go by. We make such a racket, it sounds like every pot and pan in the world is falling downstairs at the same time. All us men helped cutting trail today, and at first the track was firm and the wheels didn't sink. But by the time the last wagon passed, the trail weren't nothing but soggy mud, and we had to set down straw and pry the wheels clear. It is hard work, but I don't mind. Everybody is so friendly and grateful for our common purpose. Mrs. Tamsin Donner saw me scribbling in this journal and said to be sure to put in some stuff about rations. So here goes. We got a ration of 150 pounds of flour and 75 pounds of salted meat per person. You gotta buy that much or you can't join up. 75 pounds of meat won't last for such a long journey, but we expect to hunt game on the way. We got rice and beans and lard for frying. Every wagon has at least one spare wheel and the fixins to make more. Each family has a tent and gear for cooking, and many have spare horses. Most every man has a rifle, and mostly they're pretty handy, even if they never shot anything but rabbit and squirrel. That won't matter, as we expect to find buffalo near the Platte River, and they say buffalo are a mighty big target and hard to miss. I never ate buffalo steak, and am looking forward to it. May 15th. We are free of the forests! This morning, 3 hours after dawn, we came at last to the end of the timberlands and saw the sun rising clear over the great prairie. In Missouri, I never seen anything so wide open to the sky, just fields of tall grass as far as a man can see. No, I lie. Much farther than a man can see. More like what an angel might see, looking down from heaven. Mr. George Donner says if all goes well, it will take no more than 2 months to traverse the prairie lands, and that, come August, we'll cross over the Sierra Nevada mountains and find ourselves in California. Right off, things have improved considerable. Colonel Russell, who is helping to lead the party, rode ahead to spot for Indians. He didn't find any, but he did locate a fine hard trail that is in such splendid condition it can almost be called a proper road. No more wheels bogging down in the mud. By Mr. Donner's reckoning, we made better than 10 miles in a single day and should expect to do even better tomorrow. I shot a pheasant, and Mrs. Breen praised me so. I'm sure it made my face as pink as bunting. She says the Breens will never go hungry so long as I'm there to help provide, and she hopes I'll teach Edward to shoot as good as me. I didn't have the courage to tell her the pheasant just happened to light on a tree stump so close by nobody could have missed. Anyhow, Mrs. Breen made up a batch of fine biscuits and gravy, and that pheasant sure tasted good. Later, Mr. Patrick Breen, Edward's pa, made a fuss over putting a pheasant feather in the brim of my hat. He don't say much, but when he does, it means something. I count my lucky stars to have such friends. No buffalo yet, but birds and small game are plentiful. May 16th. Mr. James Reed kindly invited me to admire his palace today. I never seen anything like it. The Pioneer Palace car ain't no ordinary wagon. It's so big, it takes 4 yoke of oxen to pull it. The palace has got a real door and steps to get up, and inside, It's all fitted out like a little house on wheels, with a wood stove to keep it warm and a stovepipe that goes up through the canvas top. They got built-in beds below and a loft where the children sleep and a special feather bed for their grandma, who is ailing. She don't complain, but just lies in her bed and sighs a little. They even got a library in there with a bunch of books. Their daughter's name is Virginia. She's 12 years old and has a pony called Billy. When she saw me scribbling in my journal, she told me she was keeping one too. Hers will be better, I guess, because she's had more learning than me and books to read and stuff. The way they talk, I get the impression the Reeds don't think much of the Donner family. The Donner's got 3 wagons, but none of them compare to the Pioneer Palace car, that's for sure. Just before sundown, I tried for a deer, but missed, and it ran off. May 17th. After 2 hours on the trail, we came to the Kaw River and got ourselves across it and on into the frontier territory, leaving Missouri behind. Turns out the Kaw tribe owned this patch of river, and if you want to cross over, you gotta pay them. That's the deal, and Mr. James Reed said it was pretty fair considering. We got 247 wagons in our party, and it cost $1 each wagon, so the Kaw made a pile today. Mr. Breen joked how the Indians were getting even for selling Manhattan so cheap. I asked what Manhattan was, and he said it meant the same as New York, which is somewhere back east. Anyhow, them Kaw worked mighty hard for the trade. What happens when you want to cross their river is this. First, you pull the wagon as close to the landing as you can get it. Then, you unhitch the teams of oxen, which will be unyoked and then swum over. Then the Indians take charge. Each wagon gets shoved onto the landing, and from there gets manhandled onto their rickety little barge, which is a tricky business. The barge barely has room for 2 wagons. Once they get the wagons on board, the Indians pull the barge to the landing on the opposite shore and then do it all over again, only backward, unloading the wagons onto the landing and then shoving them up to the shore. They had to make a special trip for Mr. Reed's Pioneer Palace car because it's so much bigger than a regular wagon, but they still only charged him $1. Meantime, we're all busy swimming the oxen across the river. They don't like it much, but if you push hard enough, they go. And once an ox gets going forward, he won't back up. Horses mostly go better. We didn't lose 1 animal, which Mr. Reed says is a triumph. Naturally, I got soaked to the skin, but you know what? It felt good. I ain't been so clean of dust since we left Independence. We were all proud of ourselves about the crossing and slapped each other on the back and said we were sturdy pioneers and how nothing could stop us now. Then Mr. Donner came by, real somber and serious-like, and said that at the next river we cross, there wouldn't be Indians to help us and no barge to float the wagons. Mr. Reed didn't say anything, but he wasn't pleased. We got a mile clear of the landing and then made camp. Patrick Breen has a fiddle and played it very lively after supper. Everybody sung along, even if we didn't know the words, and we all felt mighty fine about deciding to go west. Later, when it came time to bed down, Mrs. Breen said I should sleep under their wagon in case it rained. Edward elected to sleep outside, too, so's I could tell him some more Missouri whoppers. He's holding the lantern while I write in my journal and says, "Hello." May 19th. For the last 2 days, we've been following the Kaw River. The land is flat and easy, though it bogs down some here and there. Me and Edward take charge of encouraging the oxen while his father and the others push and shove the wagon from behind, rocking it free of the mud. The work is hard, but nobody complains much. Mr. Breen jokes a lot and says how all of Ireland is nothing but a bog. You can tell he misses Ireland, even if he won't admit it, because he's an American now, bound for California. It don't matter where you came from, because you can't go back. You can only keep going. We got that in common with the oxen. May 20th. Rain. Bad rain. Terrible thunder and wicked lightning, too. It started about noon, but we kept going for 3 hours, trying to make a few more miles. At last, it was too much. The lightning scared the horses, so we all stopped and made camp, which today means we huddle inside the wagons, feeling scared and miserable. When the lightning goes off, you can see it flashing right through the canvas top, bright as the sun. The lightning casts a shadow, too, though it don't last long. Mrs. Breen weeps a little because she's afraid we'll be struck, and her husband comforts her as best he can. They talk real soft to each other, which reminds me of my dear Ma and Pa. God rest their souls. The Breens are very kind to have me in their wagon, as by rights, I should be outside with the other bachelors. The wagons are up on a plateau, some distance from the river, and pretty exposed to the wretched weather. Our whole wagon shakes whenever a gust hits us. The canvas top had some waterproofing, supposedly, but it ain't holding, and we're all wet and miserable as dogs. Edward jokes that I look like a muskrat with a pen, and I guess he ain't far wrong. May 29th. Virginia Reed's grandmother died today. I mentioned before how she mostly just lay on her feather bed and didn't say much on account of the sickness in her lungs. Mr. Reed says it was the stopping that did her in. As long as the wagons were moving west.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.